Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Well, we have arrived at the end of the prophecy of Hosea. And we have seen that this prophecy has called the people over and over to repentance. The question is, are they going to repent? Now just think for a moment. If someone were to come up to you and they would just say, repent, how would you respond? You might say, well, no, thank you, or not today, or why would I want to do this? And you would just keep walking. Very few people would just respond to that term, repent. There needs to be a motivation. And that's exactly what this prophecy has done over and over. Well, we're ready for the final chapter, but there's a difference. Because when we look at the Hebrew Bible, we find that there's an extra verse in chapter 14. Now, it's not a verse that's not biblically sound. It's simply, in most of your Bibles, the last verse of chapter 13. What's the difference for this? Well, we need to be aware of the fact that in the original text, there were no chapter numbers, no verse numbers. All the words just came together. But here, what has transpired is this. The sages of old understood that chapter 14 begins with repentance, and they wanted to include the motivation, a proper repentance, which is rested in what? The realization that a judgment is coming. What type of judgment? Well, look at the last verse of chapter 13 if you're studying from a Christian Bible, or the first verse of chapter 14 if you're looking at a Hebrew Bible. It reads this, and you, O Shimron, shall be guilty. Why? For you have rebelled against your God. So we see here there's guiltiness. See, one of the motivations for repentance is, from God's standpoint, I am guilty. He is not pleased with me. He sees me as a rebel. Now, most people, if you were to ask them, how does God see you? They might say, well, I'm his child. Well, that just means he created you. But he may not see you as his child. The question is, does he see you as a servant or a rebel? Biblically speaking, there's no position in between. You are either to be a faithful servant or you're going to be a displeasing rebel to him. So it says in chapter 14, verse 1 in the Hebrew, it says, O Shimron, you are guilty, for you have rebelled against your God or her God, and with a sword they shall fall. And it says, and the young children. Now, this is a word saying their babies are going to be what? Well, most Bibles say dashed to pieces on the rocks. It is a word that means to be destroyed, to be ripped apart. And then it says, and her pregnant woman, literally it's in the masculine, his pregnant women will be what? Ripped open. Now, I realize that's not pleasant. No one wants to hear those words, but it is a description of the coming judgment of God. It is a proper understanding of what's going to happen that gives us a right motivation for what? Repentance. If we love our family, if we love our children, if we want to see God's blessings in our life rather than judgment, it all begins with what? Well, let's move on now to chapter 14, verse 1 in English, verse 2 in the Hebrew. He says, Shuva. Now, the word Shuva means repent, but it means turn towards God, embrace him. And as we've seen, repentance is never done alone. Repentance is always with God. So he says, repent, O Israel, how? Unto the Lord your God. For you have stumbled, or you have failed in your iniquity. And I think that's important that we translate that properly. It's not just a stumbling, but it's a word that means failure. One that is far, not just short of, but miles away from the purposes and the plans of God. And the only solution, the only thing that's going to bring change is repentance. Let me tell you, as I read popular books from a Christian standpoint, as I listen to many people who teach like I do, we don't see many things related to repentance. And the reason for that is this. Oftentimes, when someone gets ready to teach, they say, well, gee, what passage of scripture? And they begin thumbing through the scripture. What passage am I going to speak on? And they try to find something that they think that the people are going to benefit from. I don't know what you're going to benefit from. I would not be so prideful to think that I know what you need to hear. So to avoid that, what do? We just go through the Word of God. And in doing so, we encounter things. I encounter passages of scriptures that, quite frankly, in the flesh, I wouldn't want to share. I know that people aren't interested, apparently. They're not wanting to. But you know what? That's their sinful nature. Their soul may what? Their soul may be desiring that. So what we hear here is an explanation of what God is saying to them. He's saying, you have failed because of your iniquity. So what happens? Verse 3. It demands a response. He says, take with you words. Now, this piece of scripture is very popular and well known in Judaism, where it says, take with you words. Now, many people ask, you know, today in Judaism, there's no temple. How does sin get atoned for? How is the basis of the Torah law being fulfilled? And they'll look at this passage and the rabbis will say, see here, God says, take with you words and return unto the Lord. He will say to you what? Say other things. Well, this passage of scripture, words do not replace sacrifices unless you have received that all-sufficient sacrifice of Messiah. And then our words are said in memorial to what he has done. So it's not a replacement, it's simply an acknowledgement, if we understand it rightly, of what Messiah has done in our life. So he says, look again at verse 3, take with you words and return to the Lord, saying to him, and I love this, ko tisa avon. What does that mean? Kol means every. Avon means iniquity or transgression or sin. So every sin, every iniquity, what's he going to do with? Tisa, you are going to lift up. Now, oftentimes the Bible speaks about the burden of sin. And many people are living today and they don't even know it. They're worn out. They are depressed. One of the most common reasons that people go to a doctor is, doctor, I don't know what's the matter with me. I'm just so fatigued all the time. I just don't have energy. And they're looking for a physical reason when the reason is really spiritual. They are weighed down with the burden of sin. And God says here, repent, return to me, and what? I will lift up every iniquity. And he says, receive kach tov, receive good. Now, we've studied long enough together. When you hear that word good, what comes into your mind? The will of God. So if you want this release to come into your life, you need to understand that the motivation that you have for turning to God is so that you might receive his will into your life. And then it says, and let us pay with the bulls of our lips. Now, the bulls of our lips, of course, bulls were the most precious of the offerings. So it simply say, let your words be the most precious to God. Esteem him with those words. But here again, it's not talking about a replacement of the system, but rather a transformation of the system that only comes through the sufficiency of the cross, what Messiah did in our behalf. Verse 4, he says, to Assyria, or Assyria, he won't save you. Upon a horse, Assyria, that army's not going to ride. Therefore, he says, you shall no longer say, our gods, the work of our hands, which in you, rather, we're going to find something. Now, he's making a transition here. because the people repented, he's saying, no longer are you going to trust in idols. No longer are you going to be concerned about Assyria. He's not going to help you. He's not going to get on horses and come to your aid. There's no help in him. Where's the help? Well, look at the end of verse 4. It says, for Becha, in you, the orphan finds mercy. Now, when it's speaking about an orphan, today, in many places, children who are without parents, they are just left to fend for themselves. The governments don't get involved. In fact, you go to a place like Brazil, and you'll find on some of the busiest street corners in large cities there and also in Asia, you'll find little children. In America, most of the homeless are adults. There's very few children that are homeless, and usually they're with their parents homeless. But in other countries, the most common homeless people are children, because they don't look upon the orphan. They are the ones that society just throws away, but not God. God will have mercy for the orphan. And the implication is this: if he takes care of the orphan, he's going to take care of everyone else. That one that society rejects, if he deals with him, he'll deal with everyone. What does God want to do? Look at verse 5. Now, this is the same expression that God has used before. It has to do with turning away from him. And we talked about how many Bibles translate it backsliding. And it says earlier on that Israel was determined to turn away from him. They had this tendency that could not be broken of backsliding. But what does God promise to do? When we repent in spirit and in truth, God says, look at this verse, verse 5. He says, I will heal their backsliding. I will love them how? I love this word. It's the word nidiva. Nidiva is in a generous manner. Now, if you look closely at that word and how it's used in Scripture, it means without any conditions. It means without any logical reason. It's just love in a generous, overflowing way without any thought other than the motivation to bless. And that's what God is promising to do here. I'm going to heal you, and I'm going to love you in the most generous manner. And he says, and I'm going to return my wrath from him. He's not going to receive it. For I will be as the dew to Israel. And he will what? He will blossom as a rose. And his roots are going to do what? They are going to strike the ground. The word here is to strike or penetrate until the very what? Just like they did in Lebanon. Lebanon, those trees receive what? Nourishment. Why? Because of a strong root system. So God is saying what he's going to do here, that he is going to move in a way to bring transformation to Israel. But where does all this transformation begin? It begins in one place, and that is in a heart of repentance. So here again, we need to ask ourselves, what has to happen in your life, in my life, that causes us to truly repent as the prophecy of Hosea wants us to repent? What has to happen in your life for it to become a reality? Well, here's a dangerous thing. You know, the answer should be one thing. I just need to get down on my knees and begin that repentant process. Because I know biblically that I don't repent alone. I just come in contact with the presence of God, and he walks me through repentance. That's what a wise person says. Some people think, well, you know, I'm just not motivated. I don't know what it's going to take. God does. And God might bring that very thing upon you. And it may be something that is painful, something that is shaking to your life. See, God gets repentance going by how? By capturing your attention. So what is God going to have to do to capture your attention? What thing has to happen before you give God priority in your life? Here again, watch out. Be careful. Because you may determine something happen in your life that you don't want to happen, but because that's the only way for God to capture your attention, he's going to bring it about. Well, look on to verse 7. He says, when we repent properly, there will go there, and the word here has to do with branches. And they are going to be what? It says, and his glory is going to be like an olive tree. So the branches are going to spring forth, and the glory is that of an olive tree. What do we know about an olive tree? An olive tree lasts for hundreds of years. You can go to Jerusalem right now and go in the Mount of Olives near the bottom of that mountain and see olive trees that are 2,000 years old. And you know what you see? You see one shoot after another shoot after another shoot. Exactly what it's speaking about here. See, grass, when you look at grass, it's beautiful today, gone in a few months. That's how it is in Israel. Because in the spring, we get rain and everything's so green, so green. But come about July, August, all brown. Those beautiful grass, just for a season. And then when you look at a rose or some other flower, I mean, just days and its glory is gone. But what God wants to do is to give us a glory that endures through all. His very glory, that we become the likeness of God and reflect him through our life. So it says in this passage, and it shall come about his glory as a olive tree, and the fragrance to him as in Lebanon. For those who dwell in his shadow shall return. Now pay attention to that term, dwell in his shadow. There is an inherent relationship between that word, tzel, shadow, when we're speaking about the shadow of God, and the garment of God. Oftentimes, it talks about dwelling in the shadow of his robe. Now, what's it speaking about here? Like I said, an important garment. This shadow comes from what's called the kanfot. What are kanfot? The corner. Many times in the scripture, it's spoken about the hem of a garment. And this location on the garment is related for the titzit, that is, those fringes that come out that relate to the commandments of God. So there's an expression here. What God's trying to teach the people is this. Repentance leads to what? Obedience to the word of God. And the safest place for you should be is what? In obedience with God. When you are walking according to biblical truth, when you are obeying the word of God, you are what? You are placing yourself under his supervision, under his shadow. So we read in this passage of scripture, those who return, that is repent, they are going to be dwellers in his shadow. And they are going to be what? They are going to be revived as the corn. And they are going to sprout forth and blossom as the vine. And they are what? They are going to have remembrance, his remembrance, as the wine of Lebanon. Now, what's unique about this wine of Lebanon? It endures. It gets better and better over time. So his remembrance in our life is going to get better as we think about what God has done. It is going to be more pleasing. It is going to be a greater sense of joy when we think about his faithfulness, his activity in and through our life. That's what Hosea is promising. And then look now at verse 9. We read here, and Ephraim, what more to you is their idols. Now he makes it in the personal expression. He says, Ephraim, you know, why does you need any more idols? For I have answered and I will look and I will be like the refreshing cypress. Now what he's talking about here? He's talking about how God is going to move to bring renewal, not just for a season, but ongoing. That's what that word here, Renanan, means. It's an ongoing renewal, a refreshing. Just like the cypress tree lasted and lasted, not a season, but all throughout the year. He says, for your fruit is from me, and this is where it's going to be found. Verse 10. Who is wise and who will understand these things? Now, that's a question, not just to Israel, but that's a question to all people. I mean, are we going to look at these 14 chapters of the prophecy of Hosea? And are we going to deal with them, that is, respond to them according to the wisdom of God? That's what he's asking. Who is going to be wise and respond to biblical truth in a way that can show God's power being released in their life. So look again at verse 10. For who is wise and who's going to understand these things? And then it uses the word navon. Now, this word navon has to do with one who is perceptive. Now, that's not an intuitive quality. Perception is paying attention. Perception, from this standpoint, is always an outcome of knowing biblical truth. See, God says to us, many places in the scripture, he says, watch. In fact, one of the most common places for this word watch or take heed or look out to be recorded in God's word is in the last days. When he talks about a perceptive person, it is people who are looking into this world and paying attention for prophetic events to take place, that we might be perceptive concerning the times, the seasons that we are living in. And if that is true, you know what? We're going to understand the great need for repentance today. So he says, who's going to understand these things? The perceptive one will know them. For he, and it's talking about God, for his ways are what? The ways of the Lord are yesharim, upright. Or that word yeshar can mean straight. Now, here's what it's trying to talk about. When we begin to walk upon the ways of God, God brings us without any detour, without any sidetracks. He brings us where? To where he wants us to be. It's only through being perceptive prophetically that we're going to walk on the way of the Lord, and we're going to find that they're upright. What does that mean? That they are going to be taking us upward. What does that mean? It's going to give us a new and different perspective. When we're walking straight with God, as Paul says, we're on that upward call. And we see things from God's perspective, not as the world's perspective. That's the outcome of repentance. It gives us a different way of seeing, perceiving things. Who's going to do that? We'll look at the last part of this verse. He says, the tzadikim. That is, the righteous ones. Now, understand, biblically speaking, whenever we're talking about repentance, and that's how this chapter opened up, whenever we're talking about repentance, there is a connection to righteousness. Why do I say that? Well, think for a moment about John the Baptist. He spoke about repentance. In fact, we could say that John's ministry was a ministry of repentance. And when people came out, what did he say to them? He says, bear fruit worthy of repentance. What type of fruit is that? If you check the scripture, we're talking about righteous fruit. There is always a connection, always a connection between repentance. Proper repentance brings forth righteousness in a person's life. So he's speaking here to one group of people. He says, those who are perceptive, they are going to make right decisions. They are going to make the decisions. Their life is going to reflect the character of God. And therefore, they're called the righteous ones. And they will walk in them. But that's only a remnant. It also says in this passage, but the transgressors, what are they going to do? The transgressors are going to, and it uses the word, stumble and fail. So here's what we have, a choice. In fact, when I look at the scripture, what I see over and over is God presenting choices to the people. You are either going to be those who God sees as righteous, of course righteous because of the justification of Messiah, because of the grace of God, but those justification and grace, they are going to cause a transformation where you become the righteousness of God. So there's only two things. You're either going to be righteous or what? You're going to be a transgressor. And the root of that word, transgression, is the same Hebrew word, poshea, which means criminal. And what happens to a criminal? They are sentenced. That is, judgment is given over to them. So let me ask you a question. What is it that you hope to receive from God? Are you hoping that God's righteousness, you become a recipient of that? And that is connected to what? The kingdom of God. Why do I say that? Because it says in the Word of God, we've talked about it frequently, seek first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. So that term tzedekim is speaking about a kingdom people. And those who are not in the kingdom, there's only two places. You're either in the kingdom or out of the kingdom. Those who are outside the kingdom, they are going to be where there's gnashing of teeth, where there's darkness, and where the Bible calls tzakot. What's that? Screams. Now, this is not a pleasant thing to think of, but there's such a dichotomy in the prophecy of God's word. There is either going to be singing, rejoicing. I had the opportunity last week to attend a wedding in Beersheba. And let me tell you, if there's one thing that can describe that wedding after the ceremony, was rejoicing. What we heard was music. I mean loud music. So what we find is with wedding, and the Bible speaks about the kingdom of God, how's it going to be inaugurated? As a great wedding banquet. So there's joy, there's singing, there's happiness. And outside, there's gnashing of teeth, there's darkness, there are tzakot screaming. You couldn't get two more divergent experiences. But it all comes down to one thing. Those who are righteous, what brought it about? They experience repentance with God. Those who did not, what happened? They rejected the call to repentance. So God sets, as he does so often, he says, as through he did with Moses, I set before you life and death, that you might choose life. I set before you blessing and curse, that you might choose blessing. And God, through his prophetic truth, makes it so clear what we should choose. The question is this: are we going to humble ourselves? Because the only way to choose wisely, to have that spiritual insight, it all is an outcome of humility. And Hosea's hope is this, that when he goes through in these chapter after chapter, outlining the sins of Israel, that reading about those sins, encountering those sins, might speak to you, and that you might fall under conviction. Understand, biblically speaking, there's a connection between conviction and humility. Those who encounter spiritual conviction, it's going to produce humility in their life. And it's only when we are humble are we going to desire a true repentance in our life. And we're going to experience God and his transformation.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.